The X-Zone radio and TV show is largely an opinion talk show. All opinions, comments, or statements of fact expressed by Rob McConnell's guests are strictly their own and are not to be construed as those of the X-Zone radio and TV show or in any manner endorsed by Rob McConnell, Relmar McConnell Media Company, Talkstar Radio Network, its affiliated stations, or employees.
All Hit Radio.
Welcome to the X Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
Welcome back to the X-Zone, everyone. My name is Rob McConnell, coming to you from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. If you'd like to send us an email, xzone@xzoneradiotv.com. If you'd like to visit our website, www.xzoneradiotv.com. And if you'd like to chat with us online on MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com. Graham Hancock is my guest this hour. Graham is the author of Sign and the Seal, Fingerprints of the Gods, Keeper of Genesis, Heaven's Mirror, Supernatural, and other best-selling investigations of historical mysteries. Graham's books have been translated into 27 languages and have sold over 5 million copies worldwide. His public lectures and broadcast, including two major TV series for the Learning Channel, Quest for the Lost Civilizations, and Flooded Kingdoms of the Ice Age, have further established his reputation as an unconventional thinker who raises controversial questions about humanity's past. Written with the same page-turning appeal that has made his nonfiction so popular, the fantasy adventure novel Entangled, published in 2010, is his first work of nonfiction. Joining me now from the United Kingdom is Graham Hancock. And Graham, welcome back to the X-Zone. Great having you with us.
Thank you. It's great to be with you, Rob. I'm looking forward to this discussion.
Graham, you've been researching ancient mysteries for, I believe more than 20 years now. So you should be the man to ask, why does the past really matter?
You know, when I first got into this field with The Sign and the Seal and Fingerprints of the Gods, which was published in 1995, I think I was very naive. I thought that bringing an alternative perspective on the past of humanity would be regarded as helpful and useful. But I discovered that the opposite was true, that there is a very fixed and rigid picture of our past, which is presented to us through the mainstream media and through the education system, and that there's a tremendous reluctance to turn away from this. And what I've realized as time has gone by is that that this is really part of the mind control system in our societies. If you control the past, you also control the present and the future. If you define the past in the way that you want to define it, then you are going to shape how people think in the present and how things go down in the future. So control of the past is power. And I see myself to such an extent as I have a role in this field as a liberating agent, that I am offering alternative points of view and alternative interpretations, sometimes of the same facts that mainstream academia is putting forwards. And in so doing, I hope to shift the balance slightly in the other direction, to liberate the past from the dead hand of academia and political control, and to hand it over to the people who it really belongs to.
Graham, stand by. You and I have got to take a two-minute commercial break. Plenty of food for thought there, Exo Nation. Graham Hancock is our special guest this hour. His website, www.grahamhancock.com. Once again, if you'd like to send us an email, xzone at xzoneradiotv.com, on MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv at hotmail.com, and our website, www.xzoneradiotv.com. My name is Rob McConnell. Graham Hancock is my guest this hour. We'll both be back on the other side of this two-minute break. Don't go away. Rob McConnell here, presenting an overview for Nicholas Paul Jennings, author of a fascinating book, Amen. It presents facts revealed by Egyptologists, facts that enable us to understand why Amen is the beginning of creation of God. It provides recommendations for religious leaders of the major religions to unify their beliefs and teach the word of God, love one another. Amen informs people how mankind conceived God. It was the Egyptians that developed the concepts of a soul, a hereafter, and son of God. And finally, after the worship of many gods, they conceived the belief in one universal God, the maker of all there is. For more information, visit www.futureofgodamen.com. That's www.futureofgodamen.com. Back in Victorian England, a famous theologian posed a perplexing riddle.
Why are the two top personalities in the Bible tagged with the numbers 7 and 11?
Academics agree the answer is found in the stunning discovery of a hitherto secret Bible structure explained in a new book called The Genesis Grid. The discovery is so simple that preschool children could illustrate it. Certain claims are hugely controversial and may offend some, but at the X-Zone, we've studied this awesome new book and agree with one expert, and I quote,
"These discoveries appear to be beyond coincidence."
So who or what hid this wonderful pattern in the Bible, and what might they do next? Find out more, X-Zone Nation, and read reviews on www.genesisgrid.co.uk. That's
www.genesisgrid.co.uk.
Graham Hancock is my guest this hour. Exonation, www.grahamhancock.com. Graham, you talk about a light switch being turned on in the human brain all over the world less than 40,000 years ago. Now, what do you mean by this?
Yeah, this was the mystery that led me to research and write my last nonfiction book, mm-hmm. which is called Supernatural. Meetings with the ancient teachers of mankind. And what really intrigued me, I was looking at the whole subject of human origins, and it's roughly a 6 million year story between the last common ancestor with the chimpanzee and the appearance of anatomically modern humans around about 200,000 years ago. And almost that whole period, our ancestors are just incredibly dull and limited and narrow-minded, with no invention, no creativity, no symbolism, no spirituality, nothing. I call it actually 6 million years of boredom. It even goes on after our ancestors become anatomically modern, this same very narrow, limited, uncreative behavior. And then suddenly, pretty much all over the world and pretty much at once, between sort of 40 and 35,000 years ago, it really is as though a light has been switched on in the human brain. And we see this incredible developments taking place, most significantly the beginnings of art and the first evidence of spirituality. We suddenly get incredible paintings on the walls of caves in southern Europe and on rock shelters in Africa and indeed all around the world. And these accompanying exactly the same time that the paintings are created, there's a tremendous leap forward in human behavior and in human abilities. And what the cave paintings document and, mm-hmm. and make clear is that our ancestors have acquired symbolic abilities, that they can think symbolically now, that they're not just totally plugged into the material world. They're thinking in material terms. And even stranger, on the walls of the painted caves and rock shelters all around the world start appearing depictions of supernatural beings. For example, creatures that are part animal and part human in form. There's a technical term for these creatures. They're called therianthropes, from the Greek therion, which means wild beast, and anthropos, which means man. And when you study these images, which, by the way, are virtually identical all around the world, even though these cultures were not in contact with one another, you realize that you're looking at beings who are captured or depicted in the process of transformation. They're shapeshifters. They're changing their form from one form to another. And to cut a long story very, very short indeed, it's been established now that the common factor in all of this art is shamanism and altered states of consciousness. We still have shamans in the world today in tribal and hunter-gatherer societies. And shamanism always involves altered states of consciousness, trance states, if you like. And these states of consciousness are often brought about by the consumption of powerful visionary, we call them hallucinogenic plants. And there's just absolutely compelling evidence, and I detail this in my book, Supernatural, accepted by mainstream academia, that those ancient artists must have been in visionary states and then must have been depicting what they saw in their visions on the walls of the painted caves. And what's troubling and really in a way exciting about this, that at the very moment they do that and they mm-hmm. start depicting these supernatural beings, that's the very moment that this great leap forward in human behavior takes place. And I've really gone into this in great depth, and I think that we have to consider the possibility of some kind of contact with humanity at that point. And I don't mean something quite as simple as ETs or aliens coming here from other planets in this physical universe. I think that we're dealing with something much more complicated than that, that we may be dealing with interdimensional visitors who have continued to be in contact with mankind right through to the modern age, are still in contact with shamans today in tribal and hunter-gatherer societies, and always attain this contact in altered states of consciousness. In our normal, alert, problem-solving state of consciousness, these realms and these beings are not accessible to us.
So, do you believe that it's these beings from other dimensions who are the ones who have turned on this light switch?
Yeah, and I think that it's happened. I think that it's happened several times, and I think that this is why it is dangerous mm-hmm. for our society today to be so negative and punitive about altered states of consciousness. Human consciousness is a majestic and incredible gift to us from the universe. And it's a mistake to confine ourselves to a very narrow band of consciousness when we have much more available to us. You know, in our society today, if we want to insult someone, we call that person a dreamer.
Yes.
But in ancient times, dreams were seen as a valid and important method of gathering knowledge about the world and about our situation as human beings. Same goes for visions. They're very much disregarded in modern society, and visionary states are discouraged or even punished under the law. But by doing this, we may possibly be cutting ourselves off from the next step forward in our evolution. There's a huge mystery surrounding the issue of consciousness. Science just doesn't know what it is. Scientists call it the hard problem. How do these few pounds of jelly inside our skulls transmute experiences and allow us to appreciate the majesty of a sunset, the beauty of a symphony, our love for our partner or children? Science simply can't explain how the physical object that we call our brains produces these incredible emotions and experiences.
But do we really need to understand the scientific mechanism behind it, or do we just need to grasp it, put our arms around it, and say, "Well, thank you for the experience"?
Well, I think we do, because there's a widespread misconception that consciousness is that science has proved mm-hmm. that consciousness is generated by our brains, much in the way that the factory makes cars. But there's a lot of new evidence which is beginning to push through to the public now that actually consciousness may be very different. The relationship of the brain to consciousness may be more like the relationship of a TV set to the TV signal. And this would this then raises the possibility that the receiver wavelength of our brains can be altered, and that by altering the receiver wavelength of our receiving equipment, our brains, we may gain access to other levels of reality that are not normally accessible to us. And if we work with the simple default mode of mainstream science mm-hmm. and reduce everything to matter and say that our brains simply generate consciousness, then we naturally come to the conclusion, for example, that when we die, our consciousness dies also. But in fact, there's an incredible amount of information that this is not the case, that consciousness can survive death, and that the instrument that we call our brains may be designed to give us access to more levels of reality than simply this material and physical world in which we live out our daily lives. So that's the reason why I think it's important to get to grips with this, because mainstream science has imposed a fundamentally anti-spiritual, pro-materialist view of the human predicament. It wants to reduce us simply to matter. It wants to deny that there is anything else to the human creature except the matter that makes up our bodies. And actually, science has no facts on which it bases that. That's almost an act of religious faith on the part of science itself.
So basically, we've got this multi-band receiver, and we're only on one channel because nobody's taught us how to change the frequencies.
That's exactly my point. We're tuned in to channel normal mm-hmm. Most of the time. And that phrase actually comes from Dr. Rick Strassman, who's professor of psychiatry at the University of New Mexico. And back in the 90s, Rick Strassman did some incredible work with dimethyltryptamine, DMT, and human volunteers. And he is the one, his research project is really extremely important in understanding the nature of consciousness. And it's his work which suggests that actually we have a kind of receiver or transceiver in our heads rather than simply a generator of consciousness. And once we accept that that is so, then all kinds of incredible possibilities open up. Maybe we don't need the Large Hadron Collider in Geneva, Switzerland, to break into parallel universes. Maybe we've already got the instrument to do that inside our skulls. It's called our brains.
But how come we don't have the instruction manual?
Well, I think we do have the instruction manual. This is the thing. Traditional tribal and hunter-gatherer societies have been working with these contacts with what they call spirit beings and spirit realms for tens of thousands of years. They would never consider undertaking any kind of healing activity without looking at the spiritual basis for the sickness that they're dealing with. I think it's modern society with its emphasis on pharmaceuticals, on experts, on weighing and measuring and counting science that has dismissed all of this and effectively, to use your analogy, torn up the manual and thrown it away, so that we're having to reinvent ourselves now through rediscovering these incredible processes.
Graham, please stand by. You and I have to take our news break at the bottom of the hour. Exxon Nation, Graham Hancock is our guest this hour. His website is www.grahamhancock.com. That's www.grahamhancock.com. And we'll be back on the other side of this break as we continue here in the Exxon with yours truly, Rob McConnell, from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Witch doctor's power and his ancient tribal ways cruelly collide with the force and authority of modern Africa. Africa is viewed through myriad eyes. You will never forget these characters. A young girl forced to endure a painful, cruel, and antiquated tribal custom. The sole survivor of a vicious tribal massacre. A nun who endures physical assault that compels her to question her faith. A deprived, disadvantaged schoolgirl who is infected with HIV. The translucent soul of a murdered friend. Welcome to Africa's Unfinished Symphony. While the tale of South Africa in the wake of World War II is riveting, violent, and cruel, it is also brimming with stories of kindness, compassion, and courage. Africa's Unfinished Symphony highlights commanding characters who not only bring haunting racial clashes to life, but also convey the intense conflicts that existed between archaic customs and modern influences. You will be captivated as you follow the convoluted path of Farida, of the ancients battling to become Bertha of a modern world. But are the outcomes of her struggle the best results for her and her beloved Africa? Africa's Unfinished Symphony will immerse you in historic African themes that will jolt you out of complacency and into compassion. For more information on how you can get your very own copy of Africa's Unfinished Symphony, visit www.luciaman.com. That's www.luciaman.com.
My name is Michael Telstar, Canada's leading mentalist from Toronto, Ontario.
Hi, my name is Splenda, and you're listening to my dad, Ron McConnell, on the XM.
This is Psychic Dorothy from St. Catharines, and you're listening to Rob McConnell.
Hello, my name is Holly Reeves, an astrologer from Astro4U, and you're listening to Canada's number one paranormal radio show, The X-Zone, with Rob McConnell.
Welcome to The X-Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
I just can't wait till the day when you knock on my door.
Exo Nation, Graham Hancock is my special guest this hour. His website is www.grahamhancock.com. Graham, is that why so many New Age practitioners, holistic healers, naturopaths, tell us that we need to meditate to open up our minds so that we can actually make the connection with the other realms that we have the ability to?
Yes, absolutely. The meditation really is one of a number of techniques which can lead us out of our very deeply grounded in the material realm state of consciousness and allow us to kind of dim down the lights on that and bring up the lights on the whole of the rest of reality and gain contact with it. And consciousness is the key. We're never going to gain connection with the rest of reality as long as we're locked in the alert, problem-solving state of consciousness that our society so admires and loves today. Now, I'm not putting that state of consciousness down. Mm-hmm. It's important. There's a role for it. It's part of our human heritage. But we shouldn't cut ourselves off from all the other states of consciousness that we are capable of achieving, because there may be really important lessons to learn there.
So if I was to ask you for your definition of consciousness, what would it be?
Well, I think that I think that the analogy of the TV set and the TV signal is really important. That really, if we go back to all of the ancient religions of mankind, they see humanity. They see the fundamental essence of the human being as being our soul or our spirit. This is fundamental, and our bodies are secondary. The soul or the spirit is immersed in the body in order to undergo learning experiences here on Earth. But the soul and the spirit continues on after the physical body dies. In a sense, we can dispose of that body like an old suit of clothes and perhaps reincarnate or come back in some other form. So I would say that consciousness is the essence of the soul. It is not an artifact of the physical processes of the brain. The physical processes of the brain simply allow consciousness to manifest in this particular material realm in which we find ourselves.
So would I be correct in saying that you believe that death is a physical property and not a spiritual property?
Yes, I do. I of course, I can't prove this, mm-hmm. but then nor can scientists,
yes.
when they tell us that there is no life after death. For example, Richard Dawkins, the author of the God Delusion and the Selfish Gene, will absolutely tell you that there is no such thing as life after death. That it's complete nonsense to think of things like that. But of course, he can't know that, and he's not making a scientific statement when he says that. He's actually making a statement of his own belief. And my belief is quite different. It is indeed that we are potentially at least immortal beings, and that we incarnate in physical form in order to learn lessons and to grow and develop in realms where there are consequences. And really, you know, what the very materialistic view of science cannot explain is just a huge range of anomalies. For example, near-death experiences where the patient flatlines on the ECG, but the patient's consciousness remains active. And we have reports of the patient being able to project her consciousness through the hospital. There's even one well-known case where, having left the emergency room, the free-floating consciousness of the deceased patient traveled several floors upstairs in the hospital and actually went out of a window and found off to the side of the window on a ledge a single sneaker shoe with particular colored laces. And that person was then brought back to life in the operating theater and reported later what she had seen while she was dead. And a nurse was able to go up and find that particular shoe, exactly as she had described it, but could not possibly have seen it in everyday life, was indeed sitting on that window ledge outside the hospital window. And I myself have had a near-death experience when I was 16 years old. I had a massive electric shock, which very nearly killed me. And during that experience, I came out of my body and found myself floating around the light bulb, looking down at my body on the floor. And I remember to this day that I didn't feel any fear or unhappiness. Actually, all I thought was, how interesting. And then I was plunged back into my body and back into material life again. And I just think that these areas of inquiry, these mysteries that surround us as creatures, are really worth investigating and exploring. And it's why I've taken the deliberate decision with my latest book to move into fiction, to explore these extraordinary ideas in a form where our society gives us license, as it were, to really step out there and consider the most extraordinary and extreme possibilities. And that form is fiction. And that's why my novel, Entangled, is out there now, because for me, it is the best way to explore mysterious ideas of this kind.
What do you think about aliens and UFOs? What do you think they are?
Well, we have a phenomenon here. There's no doubt about that. And the phenomenon is on the increase.
Mm-hmm.
Interestingly enough, I was talking about the painted caves in Europe 30 yes. or 40,000 years ago. There are a number of images on the walls of the painted caves, for example, at Pechmerle in France, which look very much like the kind of vehicle that we would call flying saucers today. And there are even, along with the images of therianthropes, of creatures that are part animal and part human in form, which is, by the way, a form in which UFO abductees today often experience the entities that abduct them. Along with those kind of images, there are also images, again in Pechmerle Cave, for example, of archetypal greys that we're familiar with in popular culture today. I have no doubt that this phenomenon exists. I have no doubt that people have experienced abductions. I have no doubt that there are unidentified flying objects. But I think that we may be rushing too soon to an oversimple conclusion when we insist that these must be beings from other planets who are otherwise a bit like us, but very technologically advanced, who've learnt to cross interstellar space and are coming to interact with us for one reason or another. I think that the accounts are not yet closed on this issue, and we should keep an open mind to the possibility that we may be dealing with interdimensional visitors here. Interestingly enough, there was a shaman in the Amazon who died last year. His name was Pablo Amaringo, who worked with the powerful visionary brew that I myself have also drunk many times, which is called ayahuasca, the vine of souls. And Pablo was a great artist, and he depicted his visions that he had seen under the influence of ayahuasca in paintings. And a great many of his paintings include images of flying saucers. And when I asked Pablo about this, what are these flying saucers? Why are you showing these flying saucers in your paintings? He said they're vehicles for traveling in and out of the spirit world. And when a shaman speaks of the spirit world, I think he's doing no different than a quantum physicist does when he speaks of a parallel universe or a parallel dimension. And when we consider also the incredibly elusive nature of this phenomenon, the fact that it may show up as a blip on a radar mm-hmm. screen and then just completely disappear, I think we have to stay open to the possibility that it may be even more mysterious than just physical aliens crossing this physical universe.
Why do you think people are being abducted by these creatures from another dimension or a parallel universe?
Well, again, to understand this, we have to recognize that this has been going on for thousands of years, not simply in modern times. In the past, it's been construed in different ways. In tribal and hunter-gatherer societies, these beings who typically abduct and still to this day abduct shamans mm-hmm. Are thought of as spirits, and they have certain definite characteristics. In medieval Europe, I believe that they were thought of as fairies and elves. And again, those same characteristics that shamans apply to spirits apply to fairies and elves also. And in modern times, since fairies and elves went out of fashion, and since we ourselves began to explore space, we have construed these visitors and the mysterious contacts they have with us as aliens or extraterrestrials who've come here from another planet. Actually, I would say that we're looking at exactly the same phenomenon, simply viewed through different cultural spectacles in different periods of history. And I honestly can't tell you what is going on. All I can say is that something very curious is going on, that these entities from the other side have an interest in us, that they appear to have something to teach us. It's really quite fascinating. In the research at the University of New Mexico done by Dr. Rick Strassman with dimethyltryptamine and human volunteers, very often when the volunteers came back from their DMT journey, which, by the way, lasts only about 15 minutes, they gave very much shared reports about what they'd seen there, and one particular phrase kept recurring from the beings or entities they'd contacted in this altered state of consciousness. And that was this: we're so glad you've discovered this technology, meaning DMT. Now we'll be able to communicate with you more often. So there's an intense interaction taking place here. There's evidence 40,000 years ago that it led to a huge leap forward in the human career. And more recently, in the 60s, when briefly hallucinogens and psychedelics were very widely available and widely mm-hmm. used, we saw again then an incredible creative leap forward. I think it's absolutely beyond question that the music of that period and that the art of that period and that the computer revolution itself are very likely connected to experiences in altered states of consciousness. It's not widely known, but Francis Crick, the discoverer of the double helix structure of DNA, admitted to friends before he died that he had first seen in a shimmering, glittering form the double helix while he was under the influence of LSD, which he used regularly during the 1950s when it was still legal, as an aid to his thought processes. So what Crick is admitting there is that it wasn't the alert, problem-solving state of consciousness so loved by science that led him to the double helix. It was visionary experiences in deeply altered states of consciousness. It seems we have lessons to learn from the other side. And I think it's very important and needs to be considered seriously that we should not cut ourselves off completely from the fountain from mm-hmm. which these lessons emerge.
All right, but what information have we received from the other side that could be used as proof of the existence of the other side and not just a mind-altered state that is hallucinating?
Well, see, we have to do the research. We have to do the research. Generally speaking, when a group of people who are not in contact with one another mm-hmm. and are not comparing notes, all report seeing the same things, we are inclined to accord the status of reality to those things. It's multiple. How do we know that anything is real except that other people see it also? You know, there's a huge problem over what reality is, actually.
But when it comes to something like DMT, is it possible that the chemical combination that is in the DMT is actually causing the same mind-altered effect or hallucination in all those who participate in the test?
This would be incredibly hard to explain. You'd have to say that hardwired into our brains is a module for teaching experiences which actually give you constructive information for entities that are part animal and part human in form and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. You know, I can understand why we have intuitive physics, but why we have the intuitive ability, all of us, to see creatures that are part animal and part human in form in visionary states completely defeats me, and
I
can't explain it.
The animals that have been part human and half animal have been, you know, have been told about throughout history. Look at the Greek mythology.
They're everywhere. They're in every culture. But the one place for sure they are, even in modern times, is in visionary experiences. Before the war on drugs clamped down on this interesting and important research into consciousness, mm-hmm. quite a lot of work was done with modern volunteers and hallucinogens. And again, they, when asked to depict their visions, they depicted encounters with entities that were part animal and part human in form. And Rick Strassman volunteers, although lying on a hospital bed in the University of New Mexico and therefore not physically abducted, more than half of them reported abduction-type experiences, including probes being inserted into their brains, crystals put into their brains, and so on.
All right, stand by, Graham. You and I have to take our final break. ExoNation, Graham Hancock is my guest this hour. www.grahamhancock.com. We'll be back on the other side of this break. Don't go away.
I'm William S. Peckham. If you enjoy a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love my novel, From Out of the Woodwork. It's the story of a young Toronto contractor, Sean Kennedy, who buys derelict homes, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. Slums just waiting to happen. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, the house fights back. Former owners unexpectedly come out of the woodwork as he starts the destruction. The apparitions come to him when he touches old books, reads hidden letters, rummages through old boxes, finds a locket, or reads a discovered manuscript of a murder mystery. From Out of the Woodwork will take you from 1899 to the horror of the World Trade Center, September 11, 2001. Check out From Out of the Woodwork on my website, www.williamspeckham.com.
The new nonfiction book, Razor of Madness, is similar to cult movies like Clockwork Orange, Dragon's Tattoo, or The Other Side of Hell. Wayne Morin Jr. and Thomas Lee Howe will expose widespread and systematic deficiencies in this thought-provoking tell-all novel. Mind control rages among scholars and law schools. Human rights are ignored while thought reform and mental manipulation are accepted practices used as behavior modification. Dr. Louis Jolyon West comes to mind. Media and public scrutiny shows that United States mental hospitals are in fact destructive murder industries. Razor of Madness expose novel details this epidemic through an in-depth professional and personal investigation. For decades, there has been a revolving door policy that still releases killers and pedophiles back into society. The maestro of mind control continues to haunt America to this very day. Razor of Madness is available in paperback or as a downloadable ebook at Amazon.com. If you enjoy reading a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love From Out of the Woodwork by William S. Peckham. Sean Kennedy, a Toronto contractor, buys derelict houses, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, a century house in ruins, and starts the renovation, the house fights back. He is visited by ghosts of owner's past. His visions are triggered by touching an oak mantle, reading a faded letter, opening an old locket, or opening a brand new casket in the basement. These visions will take you on a trip across southern Ontario from Niagara Falls to Toronto to Kingston. From Out of the Woodwork is now available in paperback and on your favorite electronic reader. To order your copy of From Out of the Woodwork, go to www.williamspeckham.com. That's www.williamspeckham.com.
Knowing I'll be back at Echo Beach someday.
Explanation, Graham Hancock is our special guest. We're talking to Graham about so many things today. But Graham, I'd like to talk to you more about your new book, Entangled. Tell us more.
Well, I've been writing nonfiction, as we said at the beginning, for more than 20 years. But I found myself in a subject area here that really required the approach of science fiction and fantasy adventure. And Entangled is a fantasy adventure time slip novel. It tells the story of two brave young women living at opposite ends of history, one of them today in modern Los Angeles and the other 24,000 years ago in the Stone Age. And they're brought together by supernatural forces, by a being I call the Blue Angel, to do battle with a demon who travels through time. It's a story of the battle of good against evil. In the Stone Age, this demonic force, whose name is Sulpa, is seeking to mislead humanity, to wipe out, in horrible ways, the last of the Neanderthals. If he succeeds in doing that, he's going to gain the psychic charge necessary to jump forward and manifest fully in human form in the 21st century and weave the doom of all mankind. And my two young women heroines of this story are brought together to stop him doing that, to put mankind back on the right track again. And the way that they make contact with one another and first establish contact is in deeply altered states of consciousness. In the case of Rhea, the young Stone Age woman, it's the use of psilocybin mushrooms taught to her by the Neanderthals, which enables her to leave the prison of the body and project her consciousness into other times and places. And in the case of Leonie, in the modern story, it's DMT in a project rather like that project I told you about at the University of New Mexico, and later ayahuasca in the Amazon jungle that enable her to make these journeys. So it's an adventure story, it's a time travel story, it's a story about the battle of good against evil, but woven in through the action and adventure are what I hope are deep and thoughtful speculations about the mysterious nature of reality and consciousness and the human soul. Mm-hmm. And I'm just hoping that the readers of my nonfiction, who are used to 800-page books with 1,500 footnotes, will come with me on this new adventure, because I feel very strongly that for the future, fiction...
Graham, we're quickly running out of time. Where can our listeners go to get a copy of your new book, Entangled?
Amazon.com, Amazon.ca. They can go to my website and click on the Entangled button and find all kinds of links and ways to get the book. And, of course, in all good bookstores.
Graham, I want to thank you ever so much for joining us tonight. Thank you very much. Continued success, and I look forward to the next time you and I meet here in the X Zones. Until then, my friend, take care of yourself.
Thank you.
All right, good night, Graham. X Zone Nation, Graham Hancock has been my guest this hour. www.grahamhancock.com. I'll be back on the other side of this news break at 6:30 past. Don't go away.